going, it gets so much easier. But that on demand, that first line is always the first. I just listened to this dialect coach who talk about getting in the boot.
Thank you. sit up there like my dear friend Linda. She is in my favorite seat.
I like to sit with you.
You see it all.
Yeah.
You like to sit on the couch. But you all are here to block, and listen, before we go, Reggie wants to sit in the front row, and I want to see it all, so it's all, so sit wherever you want. Exactly. This is all, to me, this is all part of the theater experience, too, is knowing where you can sit to feel the most comfortable. But here's what we're going to do.
Did you say, Anna, that she probably ran through her?
Yes.
Your pick.
What I would like, those of you in the front row, I want you to come over here. I want this center section because this is best for these actors. I know what they need. Somebody come over in here. Sit down. You have your middle seat. You all come right. Come on around here. Yeah, come on around here. And make so that right these seats are. There we go. That's what we need. Okay. Because a lot of the yay and you know, let me sign off the badge or whatever. We're all doing that. But can't emphasize enough what a favor you are doing to this cast. There does come a point where you've got to have an audience. Okay? So laugh, you know, tap with, be sure and clap. And there you're gonna throw. That's what's in it. They need to know that. Okay? And we were talking about this last show that you did, how every night the audience would laugh. So, all right. Any questions about anything? Yeah. This, when it's not this, is a huge big black room. Okay. The chairs just went down today. I have a custodian in here cleaning everything. And anybody give us a Christmas story? We didn't give us a story. No. It's all blue. The snow flakes. And the boxes. All Christmas trees. The last thing that Mr. Lacer did was the inside of the living room of an old house. And then this was the doorway. So it's called, you know, we call it the Black Box Theater.
And the peacock on the wall was right there.
Yeah. So see, everything is, you know, everything is different. And the next show that will be done on this set, the same director that you saw me, it's called Goodness for the Prosecution. So it will take place in the courtroom at a prison. All take place in the courtroom. Some are going to stand alive. Now that is a big musical. We do one big musical in here, one in two. But then it's not so much about the set, then you got to have one for everybody to do. So this is, again, volunteer. You know, don't get our volunteer all the time. I want to give you a couple things that are different about this. With some musicals, you have an open-hand music, okay? You don't get this one. This one you have an actual live band. And the last one we did, Bright Star, they were kind of in their own little hut up here. You know, this one, the band is very much a part. They are characters in this whole thing. You'll see that, so pay attention to that. They are playing piano, they are playing the fiddle, they are playing the guitar, but they are characters in this whole thing, so they very much have a presence. Pay attention to all of the different stages, because that is directed stuff. Okay, I was amazed, but I finally saw it all in its entirety last night at the directed. And everybody has jobs, there's a whole thing. So much that goes on with this one chair. I want to see what all you catch with that. Okay, the chair and the truck. So just see all of this. I said Dr. Juan and my husband Reggie, who will play Spud, wrote this. But this play started about 3 years ago. And this is in the back area when everybody's, you know, shut down, they don't discuss with you. And Dr. Juan would come to our front porch and be outside and up and do whatever he has to have, wrapped up in electric blankets, and wrote this play. You know, so it was just really been fun to listen to all of those from the lines and everything. And they write it and they edit it. And then about 3 or 4 times, they come over and serve our front porch. you know what, in that area there's too much dialogue.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm gonna give you more, okay? So, audience is here. The other thing with the stage manager is he's communicating with the tech group. He's got his, he has his actors in place. And then he turns to me as the curtain speaker to tell me to go on.
Everybody you saw upstairs earlier is just behind these wings, ready to come out. So just enjoy it. Man, you're ready.
Yes. I only come out, and he tells me I can come out. And he was quite abbreviated. Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you. That's what I mean. Welcome to the Shelby County Community Theater. I'm Cheryl Van Stockham. I'm the executive director, and I want to welcome you to Jubilee, Kentucky, which is not a real place, but you will soon feel so engrossed in it and welcomed in it that you wish it was a real place. So you're getting ready to see Jubilee Barn Dance. It's an original musical. You are the very first people in the audience to see it. So give it a go. I want to thank a few people. That our sponsors are Brigadier General Ron Van Stockham and the City of Shelbyville. I want to thank our director, Dr. Jack Wan, and Sarsha Bush. But this happens too. So we acknowledge the people that are here. I want to point out a couple things just so that everybody is safe. We have an exit right here. You need to get out, and we have an exit right around this corner if we would need to get out quickly for some reason, okay? If you would need to get up, which you shouldn't because everybody should have already visited the restroom, right? But if you, for some reason somebody needs to get up during the performance, you can go out this way, but be very careful because actors and set pieces come and go. So be very, very careful with those right here. So we hope you enjoy your trip to Jubilee Barn Dance. Thank you.
Thank you.
without you, Maynard. Listen.
On the radio, we're on the radio. Just turn the sound up, set a spell there while we do our show. We're on the radio, young and fun, you know. Cool sounds, hot drums, sing the world that we love so. Singing love songs true, sung by our gals too. Often late at night alone, but knowing I love you.
Faster, did she love me true? She said, you're damn right, I do.
It was a hell of a ride. We were so young and wild. Living life like music mattered.
Mattered more, the songs were better.
Mattered more because we sang them.
Folks, it's that time again. The time when I ask you, do you have any Hoosiers in this here hall? How about Ohio? You Buckeyes out there? And here we go now. Who's from the great Commonwealth of Kentucky? I'll tell you, looking back, what we managed to do on this little old Kentucky stage was this poor picker's dream. The best kept secret in the ever-loving Gateway to the South.
On the radio, we're on the radio.
My granddaddy, you know, I bet you remember him. Used to work here in China. This same job, cleaning up, watching after the building. Oh, but he did lots more than that. He took tickets sometimes, ran the follow spot. Oh, even counted money when you let him. I swear, he sure did admire you, Mr. Loomis.
I remember that.
I did too.
You and them Jubilee days is just about all he ever used to talk about. He always said how he wished I could have seen it for real. In its heyday, I've been wishing really hard, and so?
Who knew? Told you.
Granddad said you used to call him Pork Chop.
Pork Chop.
Yeah.
Hey, boys and girls, this kid's grandpa is Pork Chop.
Yeah.
Is your granddad still with us, Henry?
No, sir. He passed about 11 years ago. But he told me all about you. I practically grew up on stories of this place. Yeah, I guess I know just about all there is to know about all of you.
Uh-oh.
He always swore you folks in the show here were his whole life. Just like you said in that song, A Poor Picker's Dream. Look, he bragged he worked here on and off nearly 10 years.
That'd be just about right.
Yeah.
Well, young fella, I still can't figure how, but I sure am pleased that you and we showed up.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, you should be mighty proud of that grandfather
yes,
of yours. He was one of the finest men I ever knew.
Mm-hmm.
He kept me and the rest of these yahoos in line.
Oh,
most of the time.
It sure did.
What can you tell me?
There's a picture of you two together back there. It's in my locker. Let me go get it.
Honey,
All that was just the Tennessee branch of our Jubilee Barn Dance show.
Now we didn't start saying that till those folks over there heard about our dinky little show, started calling us the Kentucky Fried Opry.
Well, what the heck? He said she can't hear us anyway.
It was a hell of a ride. See? Told you so. Maybe we was small, but we was mighty.
All right.
My parents tried to turn me into a country music snob. Maybe I do get a little snooty when it comes to what country music really should be. But that's why I'm here. It's going to be my thesis. Now, the past couple months, I've been checking out a couple of colorful places all across Tennessee and now Kentucky.
Ha! We're colorful!
Oh, well, I think that's the girl talk.
I just want to be sure that I've covered all my bases. Now, one of my teachers told me about the town of Jubilee and the weekly barn dance they did here. But I'm not all that sure I'm going to find much.
Well, you may just get some surprises.
Well, you sure picked the perfect spot to come. Mr. Spud Loomis and the folks right around here kept this show on the stage and on the air for more than 10 years on pretty much nothing but plain old gumption.
It was like a miracle what we could do with pert near next to nothing. Well, using mostly locals, Spud gave a leg up to practically anybody who came by. Well, mostly just some hopefuls and wannabes like me.
We like you, Wally. We like you.
This was a sort of jumping off place. Not more than a few folks started.
And most of the performers were from right around here?
Sure were. Now, you've heard of Hank Williams, right?
Oh, Hank Williams? I thought we started him out over in Nashville on WSN. Are you saying he sang here?
No. He never did his act here. Put on this stage as far as I know. Now, the people who worked here were never really stars like that, but they knew their country music and were just plain good.
Most of us were lucky we got gas money for coming on.
We appreciate it. They just didn't dream about a whole lot more than making good music for friends and relatives right around here. Totally for the love of it. Now, I bet you never even heard of Gus Jackson. Well, other than some covers by other guys, no one else has either. He was a sort of minor league Hank Williams, but he was close to being just as darn good. Yeah, Gus had this easygoing, earthy style, a lot like Hank.
And he could hold his liquor a lot like him, too.
We don't talk about that much. Did he ever go anywhere outside of here, I mean?
Did he ever head for Nashville or Memphis or someplace like that? No. But word got out and that stirred up enough excitement about him that he'd get pretty decent offers. Fairly often, too. Mr. Loomis, Spud Loomis, he was the head man here from the get-go. Used to say that if Gus could have put down that ball, well, he might have been as big as any of those other old boys.
Damn, that boy could sing! Just couldn't keep his life together. He did some good stuff that brought folks from Memphis and even down in Nashville and the Opry out here. But he always said he couldn't cotton to big cities. So he ended up sitting tight and just hanging around here.
Maybe just a little bit too long.
You ain't wrong. I remember the first time I decided to take a chance on him. He came over here from a little town not half the size of Jubilee. Had his wife and kid with him. Showed up in an old beat-up Chrysler. Looking like rejects from the Grapes of Wrath. Now, wife, she always said she wanted to be a singer, too. But truth be told, that gal had a voice that sounded like a chainsaw on a 10-penny nail. That's the gospel truth. Anyway, she had to spend most of her time making sure Gus stayed sober enough to get to the show. Never did anything for himself. But Gus always showed. Without fail. Drunk or sober, Gus always.
I can tell you for absolute certain about what a following he had. I know, because my grandpa was in the audience most every night, right up there. The night Gus sang on this stage for the first time, well, he decided to sing a song he wrote himself called Get Out of My Way, Cowboy. And those farm folks, they just fell in love with him from then on, especially the ladies. Look, he was a good-looking guy. Country boys back then, they was always moaning about being lonely and feeling lost.
Dr. Francis, this old boy just loved those songs.
He had this one he called Lonesome, Lost, and Feeling Sad. Now, I would say that's just about as heartbroken as a man ought to get.
I've just somehow got some friends with a little extra money in their pockets to help him record it. And that did as much for the Jubilee Barn Dance and WBWK, but not so much for Gus.
Up to then, nobody had heard of the show outside of 20 miles.
20 miles? Later on, some more folks came over from Lexington and Frankfort and even down in Louisville, started posting what we had going on. And a couple of bluegrass DJs even started calling Gus, the king of Kentucky hillbillies. Just like Hank was the king most everywhere else. Now, I was grateful. But that ain't to say that he couldn't be trouble. Oh. It turned out for a while there, I may have been the only real friend he had.
Funny that little gal should mention Cold Cold Heart. But you know, everybody always seems to forget. It wasn't Hank Williams, but
a fella named Tony Bennett that ended up with the biggest hit recording of that.
Think about that. Hank Williams and Tony Bennett singing the same song. And here was our own Gus Jackson doing what those big stars were doing just as well, some would say even better, right here on this stage.
I loved it. Woo-wee! It was country on overdrive. That's why I wrote my first lonesome song the way I did. It seemed like on radio all you could hear was a bunch of lovesick cow folks. So I just sort of figured I'd join the club too. Woo!
Hey, look at this. Here it is. Fall of 1948, and the first time Gus ever sang Lonesome, Lost, and Feeling Sad on the air.
I always like to tell the hometown folks that Gus sang that song with a yodel and a sob, alongside some other emotions that just hadn't been heard nor seen here before.
Wow. I always wonder what it would have been like to have heard him sing that for the first time.
I remember I introduced it kind of like this. This portion of our show is brought to you by Granny's Best Syrup. Gus, old buddy, before you sing, tell the folks your true feelings about Kentucky's favorite syrup. Now, we always loved our sponsors, but we joked around about commercials.
When I die, just bury me deep with a dark green step step and get in feet. Put a cold bucket in each of my hands and I'll stop my way to the promised land. Never got in any trouble about it, though. Thought I might.
Well, I have to say, it was truly beautiful. A shopping cowboy! I have a picture of you and Grandma riding down the trail with a biscuit in each hand and a saddlebag full of sorghum. All right, friends, all. Here's the Gus Jackson you all want.
Sal Hepatica.
Why? Is Sal Hepatica any different?
I should say it is,
What millions have found that it is not only a quick, yet gentle laxative, but it also counteracts gastric acidity. Chases that sickish feeling fast, just you wait and see.
I can't get it.
deodorant and new Mum Mist. If you are one of the 2 in 5 people who perspire freely, try wonderful new Mum Mist. Now with hexachloroform.
Long trip!
Long run! 59 cents at your store today.
Margin to a different drummer.
Did you hear that?
Did
crazy, but I keep thinking that I'm hearing something.
I know what you mean. I hear sounds like that all the time. Must be the air in the place.
Yeah, sure is.
Up till now, I've never met anybody who seems to have the same kind of honest affection for this kind of music the way that I do. Maybe it's just me, but I swear, I think you do too. Oh, and another thing, it doesn't hurt that you're so easy to talk to. And so open to sharing old voices, new voices, different voices.
I like you too, Henry. Woo! Look at them, that's so sweet.
I should be the one thanking you for writing about all the things that make it all worthwhile for the likes of me.
The likes of you? How is that supposed to mean?
I don't know you, but you're pretty. You're from that other music city. Old timey, rich with famous singers. Here we seek newfangled pickers. Yet here we are and still we wonder what crazy spell we're living under.
But long before the music starts, let's find those valleys in our hearts. That which brought me, brought you.
Hard too.
Well, she should
surely was pretty. You know, this picture shows her with her plain acoustic guitar, just simple and down to earth. Now, your Maggie fits right in with what my grandparents loved and admired about the music and the way that young ladies ought to present themselves while on stage. Now, they thought anything new, the way you dressed, horns, drums, electric guitars, pretty much anything that wasn't back porch strings, tools of the devil when it came to the country music they loved and grew up with. And now that passed down to my mom and dad. And, they never really did like rockabilly or Elvis or anything that wasn't old timey.
I like Elvis in the movies though.
Mr. Loomis was always willing to experiment with new things, try out new people, even locals with a dream. If you were a hillbilly music wannabe, you were always welcome here.
Come to Jubilee! Finally, again, presenting one new talent after another. And we did find some. We had our fair share of country pickers and singers come through here who could have held their own with most of them.
I said Mr. Loomis loved the most, and someone brand new showed out of nowhere. You guys remember. Thought I'm right, you do.
That's right.
True rose snuff, always mild and satisfying. And don't forget, you can save valuable
coupons.
You know, country music needed places like this to find the new blood, maybe try out new sounds. New sounds of bigger shows couldn't afford to risk.
Just give us proven artists with hit records under their belts.
And those shows were great. They were. I listened to them on the radio and bought those recordings like everybody else.
The Grand Old Opry, the mother church of country music.
But like Spud always said,
we love our roots. Innovate, doggone it. Somebody's got to try new things.
Yes, yes.
If you're not willing to take some chances on some little people, if you don't love it so much that you're willing to take risks, why do it?
You know, it's easy to see how eager Spud and the rest of the barn dance folk were about staying open to anything new and different. And you, my friend, still are. Now, I see what you're saying, but I have long since been converted to liking or even tolerating something brassier, drummy, or electric.
No, you better be careful. This place will do that to you, but it doesn't mean that you can't hold on to your Music City favorites. You should. I sure do. I'm a certified hillbilly and proud of it. Those folks that watch the show on every Saturday night always got their 60 cents worth.
Or a whopping 30 cents if you were a kid.
That's right.
You know, whatever the air in this place is doing to me, I'm starting to think, and right here, right now, that we're not all that far apart. Maybe if Mom and Dad were here, who knows? Maybe, I'm a little bit country.
Oh, I know. And I'm a little bit rock and roll. I always like that tune. Good message, huh?
But still. Oh, wouldn't it be wonderful if by the end of the show, those two young people ended up sweet on one another.
Now, there you go again.
Being
an incurable romantic. Just like you always are.
That's how I'm
enjoy that, Miss Stanton.
So did I, Mr. Jenkins. Now, I have been waiting patiently. Are you going to tell me about Rob Wesley?
I sure am. Now, Rob was just this kid that showed up one night, and he absolutely adored Elvis Presley and everything about him. Built his whole act on him. Now, he did not want to be an impersonator like those Vegas guys.
At first, because he was not very good, but he kept getting better and began growing on all of us. Pretty soon, he had a sizable following.
What's that?
He was a real good-looking kid. And talk about enthusiasm. It wasn't long till all the high school girls from miles around would show up here on Saturday night just to see him.
He could swallow those bummy socks.
You know, local DJ named Country Bob Enos used to say, "Kid's got the moves, he's good looking, and he's got even better voice than Mr. Blue Suede Shoes." Now, you told me a while ago you'd heard of him. So you more than likely have heard of some of his recordings.
Oh, I sure have. Man, as much as I loved Elvis, I remember feeling almost unfaithful when I would listen to Rob Wesley sing some of his love songs. Oh, he was so handsome. And you're saying he started out here?
Sure did.
But before you folks out there get to hear about him, let's pause to stretch our legs and for station identification, this is
determined to do the exact same thing.
In spite of how he decided to dress for the occasion.
That kid, Rob Wesley, did exactly what we've been talking and singing about. He took the best of three or four pretty darn different worlds and, well, because he loved them all, turned it into, well, I guess the biggest thing that's ever happened around here, at least, what Elvis was doing in both country and popular music everywhere.
That rockabilly sound.
Rob Wesley was doing right here at the same time.
I always thought that kid had the makings of a better voice than Elvis. Had more color, texture, I guess you'd call it.
I had a bunch of Rob Wesley 45s up on my shelf, yeah. Right next to Elvis, Fabian, Ricky Nelson, all the heartthrobs of that time. Oh, Rob Wesley.
Mr. Loomis had this one story he never got tired of telling about young Rob's first night on the show. It was right after one of those big shot executive types had told him,
"I'm sorry, son. I'm afraid you're a little far out for us. Maybe you ought to go back to washing cars.
Wesley was just a kid, claimed to be 18, but, well, found out later he probably wasn't even that.
His mom and dad had to come over here with him to sign his contract because he was still a minor.
Well, are you gonna tell me the story about the introduction?
The way Mr. Loomis tells it.
I remember. I told it kind of like this. Ladies and gentlemen, let's have a big jubilee welcome for a brand new face on our stage. Mr. Rob Wesley. Rob, how are you this evening?
Just fine. How are you,
Mr. Loomis said he always called him sir, and that he was the most polite young man he'd ever met. Okay.
Are you all geared up?
We're ready.
Let's hear your songs.
Well, I'd just like to say how happy we are to be here. It's a real honor to get to perform here in Jubilee, Kentucky. We're going to do a song for you. Got anything else you want to say?
No, young fella, I think we're ready. Are you all set?
We're ready.
And boy, howdy, was he ever ready.
Gonna do a song for you. Got the promise of a single coming out next month. And it goes a little something like this.
Does no matter how I try.
I love this, but it just ain't getting it for me. I feel like rocking! We're rocking, planning, grabbing you. Keep rocking till you're black and blue. Keep rocking till your dreams come true. Now, mama, she knows how to rock. My papa, he knows how to rock. My sister rocks like all of us. If my babies rock, I love the best. Now we're rocking, and it's clear to see. I need my baby back with me.
I love you, Ron.
We're rocking.
Now there's a rock and send my baby back to me, sung by Mr. Ron Wesley. I bet that baby of yours is on her way.
But why him? There had to be plenty of young guys trying to be the next Elvis.
I've thought a lot about that. My grandpa said that the young boy just hung around the barn a lot listening to Gus and some of the other guys fiddling around with their music. Gus especially.
He had a gospel influence that a lot of country singers had back then. That would have helped.
But you know what surprised everybody this one time? Even Mr. Loomis, I'll bet, was when young Rob said that his favorite singer was Dean Martin. Crazy?
That boy was able to come up with a sort of tender, wounded, sometimes almost desolate sound.
But real romantic, too.
And it was so new and so special that he wowed all his audiences, all ages.
One time I looked out there, and I saw a little girl, her mother and her grandmother,
listen real close to how that kid sings, and you'll hear a little Dean Martin and some old Gus sneaking in.
Mostly me. God, I love that kid. He was something else.
Of course, his gyrations didn't hurt. Well, I guess he did it a little better.
Whatever it was, one thing was for sure. The Wesley era had come to WBWK. I heard you tell her that he did over 50 performances here. That's the truth. And that young boy was always totally loyal to his roots. He knew where he came from, never forgot who helped him. Yes, sir, Rob had to be, bar none, the greatest success story from around here. That's for sure.
That's for darn sure.
So now we've got Gus Jackson, Maggie Hatfield, I knew about her. And Rob Wesley.
That's a pretty impressive lineup, I have to admit. I had no idea.
Oh, but there were plenty more. Bo Hopkins, Patty Prentice, why, even crazy old Wally Davis when he wasn't gone fishing.
Yes, sir, Gus Jackson, Maggie, and me too, I reckon. Got it all going. Then kind of passed the torch to
the
kids like Rob. Well,
where'd
you get off to this time?
Doggone it, Spud. I can't help it. There was a fight. But I did hear you talking about Gus and Maggie and Rob and all. And, well, I couldn't help but think that maybe you wanted me.
Oh, you're right, Wally. Henry, you forgot something, didn't you? You haven't mentioned who a lot of folks thought was the most talented country singer ever to work here. A cowboy who went totally unnoticed by most everybody outside of Jubilee. That fool guy accomplished so doggone much, and he practically never got recognized for it at all.
That's the truth. I did almost forget. I know exactly who you mean. Wally Davis's old fishing buddy.
This ought to go great in her thesis over there.
There was this one more super talent. Got his stuff together in this old building. He was like one of those cult figures. Virtually unknown to most,
but like a god to his fans.
They treated him like a mountain sage or guru or something.
Know who I mean? I'll give you a little hint. I did the crime, so I'll do the time. One more chance.
Cooler Blues.
I've heard of those songs, sure, but those are all hits from big name recording artists, not anybody from around here. But were they?
That's what I'm saying. The man who wrote those songs never got the credit for it, never even tried to get it. A lot of big shots, slick agents, promoters, used him something awful. Downright stole from him sometimes. But, crazy as it sounds, he never fought back. No lawsuits or anything like that. Seemed he was just content to sit out back here and make music.
So you're telling me that Gus Jackson, or someone from here, was writing all those hit songs?
Not Gus, but come to think of it, I mean, he was sort of like that too. No, it was this other guy we were just talking about. Name it Jordan Price. Came out of nowhere. Lived right up back there.
Spent most of his time with me, singing to the squirrels and the trees, but all the time writing wonderful tunes. Mostly ballads. Jordan Price had a real old-time attitude about performing music. Always said that the song had to come before the singer.
Hello, I'm Jordan
Price. And now you really need to fill that little girl in about Jordan. Peculiar as he was, and he was surely that. I never saw anybody's music rise from nothing, from total obscurity to what his did. He was a force of nature. That's the truth. That's exactly what he was. And without fail, he always wore that same old-fashioned black suit. But he did perform, without fail. He opened up with the same song. Did it all 10 years. He was around.
I did the crime, so I'll do the time.
My calendars replace the clock. But the days go better on. 10 weary years have plodded by. 10 more till my time's done. These prison walls are bleak and bare. They play dirges on my soul. I'd like to fly away from here. Lady Justice took her home. Well, I did the crime, so I'll do the time. When I'm free, you won't see me ever near no prison wall. When I get free, I'll pack my gear, go the way I should. Show the world that God loves, agree I hate my dreams.
Amen.
Till you've been caged, there ain't no way to know what thrill me. So listen hard, be on your guard, sure how your future leads. Well, I did the crime, so I'll do the time. When I'm free, you won't see me ever near no prison wall. I did the crime, so I'll do the time. When I'm free, you won't see me ever near no prison wall.
getting into fights with local tough guys, drunk. To this day, I don't think anybody can come up with three sentences about who the man was or what he did or didn't do. He was a total loner, a real man of mystery. That was old Jordan Price.
I do promise. So I'll do that.
Did you hear that? You've done it again. This is good stuff. You've given me another pretty amazing story. Jeez, who would have thought?
I did the crime, so I'll do the time. Well, Jordan had a couple that were sort of like that. But the doggone man was such a loner. I guess, in a way, that's sort of like me. I like being by myself. Though I'm not really bad company, I just... As nearly as spudded my granddad could figure, Jordan did have a kid or a younger brother down south somewhere because he wrote this one amazing song about a young soldier coming back from the overseas after the war. I mean, just take a look at these words.
You know, I wrote that song one night around Christmas time. It's in a bar over near Hawkins. I remember. Lyrics were coming at me almost as fast as I could write. I reckon I met that much. 20 minutes of
space. Spud said with that, when Jordan first showed him that song, he knew there had to be something real personal in it.
That's when they came up with the idea. It must have been about a son or a brother. It just seemed that close to his heart.
Mr. Loomis said it looked like the man wanted to cry.
You remember that, my friend? I can't think of a better cue to ask you to do it for us right now.
Makes no difference where I roam. Kentucky is my only home, so take me back to my Kentucky. With your love I've been so lucky, tucked safely in my heart while I was gone. Free and dancing when we met, hoping you are waiting yet. For waiting days when dreams and hopes are gone. So take me back, I love you so, as first we swore so long ago. I worked the fields till duty called, a small-time boy with a soldier's heart. Our nation knew how to train a working man. When I reached the beach, I marched forward through the sand. Now the medal's here, and the stars were there by this small-time boy who's reaching out to you.
Take me back to my Kentucky. With your love I've been so lucky. Come save me in my heart while I was gone. When the sun is shining bright and the corn is harvest time, let me be a drop of love for you.
A song like that had to have been about somebody he cared about big time.
don't you think?
Sure sounds like that to me. And that's exactly what I've got to capture in what I write about. What a beautiful song, and the message, coming back to your love. Now that is close to home for everybody. So, now we have Gus, Maggie, young Rob Wesley, and you have added a real eccentric character to my list of new friends. But I don't care if he's a little peculiar. Jordan Price is now officially added to my lineup.
And here we stand, right on the very spot where it happened.
Thank you, Henry. This has all helped me so much. I never would have guessed. No wonder I'm beginning to feel like I actually know these songs.
Hearts are fusing, have we found here something more?
For hearts are all a beating, all as one and each alone. There's a bass and one is singing, swinging lips to the forlorn. We think we know these voices, for we hear them all inside.
There's a tremble full of feeling, being picked up, held, and bound.
This is music that we know. Radio, young and wild and old, living life like you.
even newer pal, the little lady that's going to keep you from forgetting us, Miss Ellie, have been reminding us. We're around. All of us. We'll always be around. This ride we took just keeps on chugging along in new ways to new places. We've all just shared one of them. So thanks for joining us here and celebrating in my favorite old barn in Kentucky on the Jubilee Barn Dance Show. Let's do it all again. All of us. Good night, everybody!
Salute to someone. Does anyone know who it is?
Annie Pearl.
Annie Pearl. Yeah, a lot of people still know her, I think.
How much
she wore that hat with the price tag on it.
And of course, Grandpa Jones is actually from my home county in Henderson.
Yeah. Any other comments? Well, I need to give them a couple of notes, so we'll let you guys go in there and give your
Thank you guys for allowing us to attend.
Thank you.
Break legs tomorrow night.
Thank you very much.
But 58 minutes was what it had been running for a couple of nights. Tonight it went right at 55 plus. It just really, and those when those one-liners are topping what follows and reacting to them, it just makes the music of the show. Reggie and I talk about this quite often, that Shakespeare, whatever plays you're talking about, there's music in the words. And if you will do them at the rate, you know, with the covering up and picking up and picking up the cues and so on, the music comes through. And if you guys did it tonight, if you don't do it any better than this, I will be a happy camper, but I guarantee you, you're going to do it better than this, or you're going to be shot. It was a really good show. I'm not going to send you notes tonight because I have only a few specific things I want to say. Take advantage of that rest tomorrow. You need it, you deserve it, and so on. But run your stuff out loud at least once, you know, during the day or in the evening tomorrow, or in the daytime Friday, so when we come in here, hopefully Friday night, maybe the country gods will be with us and the weather will be good, but we'll have our official grand opening and a large crowd. For those of you who had family coming on Thursday, for their benefit as well as ours, I think we had to make the adjustment we made. And I don't think we're going to lose anybody in terms of people coming to see it. They'll just come a different night. You have a whole pot full of people coming to this. And I know several of you had folks coming. But I wanted to make the decision early so that we knew what we were doing.
Thank you.
And then go through the day tomorrow going, I wonder what is going to happen. Okay, a few notes. But again, the big note is, by God, you got it. You got your show. And what Reggie and I wrote, I think I can let Reggie say it now. We're proud of it. Really. A few comments. The big thing that happened up there tonight, when you had that audience out there as that extra cast member, your need to tell the story suddenly emerged. You needed to tell them who you were and what you were doing. And from Spud right on down, Spud just was just wallowing in that audience. I've been watching night after night, see that wallow too much. But I mean, you know, it was really good. Right from the beginning, like when the I Remember I Do Too, when those came in right on time like that, things just moved. And all the little one-liners as they would come in, it just really made things move.
A couple of thoughts. Wally, your uh-oh was really good, but your you were kind of facing upstage. Take that thing out front and then refer back. And I really want to hear that clearly. L.A., your young woman was the best she'd ever been. She was really good. I don't have for any reason other than that she was just damn good. All right. Anybody in here, all of that opening, I asked them at intermission this one. We've got it clear now, but I do think the whisper singing helped. I think it's a good, clear opening now. Very interesting. Always, you can punch your operatives more. Tell us what's important. I took a canoe trip, and when I went on that trip, right there on my left was this beautiful garden. And then I went a little further, and this is gigantic tree. What beautiful garden and gigantic tree are what we saw, what we need us to know is important. So tell us what's important about what you said. Ellie, you were much better, and we got several good comments. Marty, this will please you. They love the chair bits. They were working well. You were working for the audience, and I thought Spud had a definite click tonight. You were really Spud talking to the people, not Reggie showing us Spud talking to the people. You were Spud talking to the people. Maggie, lovely. But I will add to that, you are maybe physically strolling a little bit when you're standing. Maybe want to stand still a little more. You seem to be moving a little more than you needed to, back and forth, and so on. And you might look at that. But other than that, wow. All of you, wow. Blah, blah, blah. I'm not going to topping all everywhere where you topped, it worked. Couldn't you feel it every time that it sat? It just made all the difference in the world. The cues are rolling now. And then the final thing I'm going to say, and the thing that everybody who's talked to me about the show thus far in the rehearsal has said, and it pleases me so much. This is a living example of how the least number of lines, the smallest member of a cast, becomes extremely important. Everybody is talking about, you heard what the guy said even tonight, everybody is making this show work. Anything that's going on out here is being buoyed up by what's going on back there. And that's what makes it so wonderful to watch. And what we wanted, because that's what it's a show about. It's a show about people who care enough about each other to want to come back and do it again. You know, and I felt like that's what happened tonight. Do you have any questions or comments or thoughts or problems? I am so happy to be able to say I won't see you for a day or so. I will miss you. I've gotten in the habit of seeing you every day. And you have made a lot of sacrifices for this, between COVID and bad weather and things like that. We have to struggle. But that's what artists do. And it sounds hokey, but here in Little Shelbyville, Kentucky, we're being artists. We're making art. And don't let anybody laugh at that and say, oh yeah, sure, making art. We're all going to ride with them. That's what we do. Okay, Tim, anything? Or Lynn, anything? Or David?
Good. Good. It's very important you get tomorrow off, drink lots of water. You hydrate the night before for the next day. So start hydrating yourselves tomorrow. So Friday night there won't be an issue with you getting thirsty or having to pee a lot because you're drinking. Get your water in tomorrow. You sounded great tonight. I was so happy to see you all.
That was really a good sound.
Yeah.
David, do you got something? First thing, most important, this was Tom and Tucker's first show.
So welcome to the tribe, guys.
David, did you have anything you'd like to say?
It's all good.
Let me finish this up. I like the Spuds. Wilkins?
Rob Wilkins.
I didn't know I wrote a character named Rob Wilkins.
Rob Wilkins.
He was still new then. Wally, be careful that your lie about But Real Romantic 2 doesn't get buried. Be sure we see you. He's such a fun character to watch now. We need, I don't know whether it has to be the bow tie or what, but do you think, you help me here, does Spud's line about, despite the way he dressed for the occasion, it doesn't seem to me right now that he is dressed extremely enough for Spud to say that.
He's not.
Don't you think we need something more garish or startling or not? I mean,
He was dressed like a regular guy when he was like,
I thought Leanne said, is that a second shirt or a...
This is the second shirt.
Okay, it looks good and it works fine, but I still kind of like the bow tie. I know you hate the idea, but
because I hate ties.
Well, anyway, we'll work on that.
I do have one thing.
Yes, please.
We need to pull the banner a little tighter.
At the end, I suddenly realized in the lyrics that I wrote and in the music that we think we know now, and when you're singing that together, a little more realization in that. You do know now. You've learned something. Not only have we taken the trip, but we have learned something about ourselves and about why this was important to us and so on like that. And then one final note for Lynn. Those love of music, love of whatever, did the pitches sound right to you on those?
Yes. I didn't notice any.
Did you guys yourselves feel Harry, Ellie, and some love of music, love of music?
Are you talking about the part where we sing independently?
Yeah.
Did
that feel off to you at all, or was it my bad ear? It sounded like, for me, and again, I have no real expertise except a lot of music, but it sounded like they were singing those words without breath, and it made them kind of go.
That will make you go flat.
That was good, and it flattened. So if you didn't breathe and come in and say love over using, then you're not over using.
Guys, you take
a look at that.
All right, I will.
The relationships on the stage are rich. Off the stage are rich. And I am very proud of this show. Now, don't let go of it, and let's keep it growing. And can you imagine, with just a few people you had tonight, what fun it's going to be with this?
Yeah.
Okay, no questions? Everybody get their say?
Yeah.
Go home.
6:30, home Friday, 6:30.